Nobody knows what the self-driving cars of the future will look like. Once you no longer need a human in the front seat operating a vehicle, automakers can rethink every aspect of car design. Since the late 1960s, however, the federal government has enforced detailed safety standards governing the physical makeup of the car.
Virtually every part of the car has had a standard written about it. There's about 100 different subjects that have been covered both in advanced notices and in actual standards.
The federal rulebooks, which have expanded over the years, have specifics on everything from rearview mirror and steering wheel placement to the shape of the vehicle and the exact placement of the seats. Since self-driving cars don't need rearview mirrors, steering wheels, or even seats necessarily, what should the federal government do with its roughly 900 pages of regulations?
I will make the contention that will rattle the cage of some people in the auto regulation business that basically the entire vehicle code can be boiled down to be safe and do not unfairly get in the way of other people.
Brad Templeton is an entrepreneur and software architect who has worked as a consultant with Google on its self-driving car project. He says most regulation will become unnecessary and detrimental now that motor vehicles are becoming essentially computers on wheels, meaning software, not just hardware, is essential for safety.
It's necessary to bring that tried, true, trusted means of regulation to bear.
John Simpson works at the California-based nonprofit Consumer Watchdog. He says that the transition to self-driving cars doesn't mean we don't need stringent safety standards.
You don't say the algorithm will be written this way, this way, this way, and this way. What you do is you set a standard that says the vehicle shall be able to do X under Y circumstance.
But the switch in emphasis from hardware to software could change the incentive structure in the car industry in ways that make government oversight less necessary. One difference is that when companies discover a safety flaw, they'll have every reason to fix the problem immediately. With today's cars, that hasn't always been the case.
Take a classic example. General Motors found a flaw in the ignition switches, and they didn't do the right thing.
The American public were failed by a corporate culture that chose to conceal rather than disclose.
Replacing every ignition switch is very, very expensive, and so they were afraid of that cost.
But the safety problems of the future will primarily be bugs in software, not hardware, so they'll be fixed by sending ones and zeros over the internet without the need to return hundreds of thousands of vehicles to the manufacturer.
Replacing software is free, so there's no reason to hold back on fixing something.
Another difference is that when hardware was all that mattered for safety, regulators could easily inspect a car and determine if it met standards. With software, scrutiny of this sort may be impossible because the leading self-driving car companies are developing their platforms through a process called machine learning.
Machine learning certainly doesn't mesh in with traditional methods of regulation or of software development, frankly.
With this method, the vehicle recognizes patterns in its environment and refines its own system through driving experience. But machine learning, which is a form of AI, is developed organically, so humans have limited understanding of how the system actually works, and that makes regulators nervous. Templeton fears that our desire to understand and control the underlying system could lead governments to prohibit the use of machine learning technologies.
It turns out that they do a better job, but we don't know why. We'll be in this situation of deliberately deploying the thing that's worse because we feel a little more comfortable that we understand it.
Good. You shouldn't be made to do it. It's as simple as that.
John Simpson says extreme caution is warranted because software in cars isn't like software in other contexts.
It's one thing to test Gmail in beta mode that glitches and you lose your messages and you say, oh, hell's bells, I lost my messages, and software that when it glitches actually might kill you. And I think that's an important distinction to make.
That these need to be perfect before we can allow them on the roads is a mindset that has infected a lot of urban planners and a lot of just the general pro-regulation set.
Mark Scribner is a senior fellow at the free market think tank, the Competitive Enterprise Institute. He says that it's this mindset that could cost lives on the highway.
Delaying self-driving car technology means we are going to see additional deaths that we could avoid if we simply would have allowed these vehicles on the road that are not perfectly safe, but still safer than the cars we have today.
The computerization of driving also has an impact on how we build and maintain highways. Some transportation planners say that to prepare for self-driving cars, we need to construct smart infrastructure that communicates directly with vehicles. Templeton says that as driving becomes a software-based industry, the physical highway should mimic the internet.
So the internet, we like to call it the stupid network, and that's because a network is really, really simple. When you're talking about cars, you talk about stupid roads and smart cars. You don't try and make the infrastructure smart, you make the infrastructure as basic as possible, and you put the intelligence in the cars where it's being built by lots of competing companies, and that's where you get the piece of innovation that shook the world that the internet had.
If we need to install all of this new electronic infrastructure on highways, and we're having problems filling potholes, just from a pure budgetary and management perspective, you're dreaming.
Physical infrastructure takes decades of planning and implementation.
Templeton says self-driving cars provide an opportunity to make the roads quite a bit dumber than they are today.
You take what infrastructure you do need to have, and you move it into the cloud. An example is the maps that Google uses for their car to drive, and they mapped all the roads, so they don't need anybody to paint new lines on the road. They use that virtual infrastructure, much cheaper, much more flexible, much more ability to change your mind about what you want.
Auto safety technology driven by the private sector is evolving much more rapidly than the federal regulations. And some of them, right now, very clearly stand in the way of consumers adopting these safer technologies.
The more real danger is that the benefits of this technology will drive us to ignore the necessary safety regulations right now.
The impact that computers will have on society is really, really big here. You need a world where people are free to come up with new innovations that everyone else thinks they're crazy.